Luke chapter 10, verse 38. If you'll stand with me for the reading of the word, I promise you stand for a few minutes. I'll stand the rest of the message, okay? I'm going to put emphasis on words, and if you'll pay attention to that, I promise I will keep this short. But if you miss the emphasis, I'm going to have to emphasize. Are you with me today?
Amen.
Just because I'm feeling all weepy don't mean I ain't who I am. Come on, man. My dad taught me how to lecture. Boy, I endured some lectures. I fell asleep to some of them lectures, praise God. But I love him for it. Now it came to pass as they went that he, Jesus, entered into a certain village. And a certain woman named Martha, listen to this, received him into her house. Let me say received. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. Verse 40. Because you have to understand, there's a lot going on here. And so he gets to the crux of the matter. He says, but Martha was cumbered about with much serving. Anybody doing any serving? You know who you are. Cutting the grass. Here for every night of prayer. Early for church. Here for every pre-service prayer. You know who you are. Music practice. Sunday school prep. Sermon prep. We had a crazy May. But Martha was cumbered about with much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bitter therefore that she helped me. Jesus said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. No one will question your diligence. Oh, you are the epitome of busyness. Some of us wear busyness like a badge of honor. You wear the lack of sleep and burning the candle at both ends like a badge of honor. Like, look how many hours I get it. Been there, done that. Not only do I have the t-shirt, but I got the 100-year-old face that goes with it. But one thing is needful. There's a lot of things you want to do, but there's one thing you really need to do. And Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. Jesus, we thank you so much for your presence here today. Your love, your mercy, your grace. The power of your presence that's in here. Lord, for just a few moments, I ask for your help. I ask for every heart, mind, and spirit be open to the word of God, for the fertile seed to be planted in that soil, that it may germinate and grow and produce fruit in Jesus' name. And if you have a good attitude, you can be seated. Jesus is telling Martha that there's a way to treat him as a guest. Many people invite Jesus in, but they ignore his word. You ever been invited to somebody's house and they get so busy doing it, you never get to sit down and talk? I like being treated special when I'm invited to someone's house or to dine at a nice restaurant. I've seen a plethora of different ways to be treated. You know, as an evangelist, a lot of people think, man, you get to wear nice suits and get treated great. I'll be honest with you, man, there were a few times I was treated pretty good. I remember being flown into a wonderful city and Man, they put me up at the Hilton. They gave me a driver. Every restaurant we went into, we pulled up, got out, and they took our car to park it for us. Treated me like a king. It's wonderful. But there's been places when I pulled up, the pastor said, there's the trailer you're staying in. I'll see you Sunday. Now, I remember going into that 1950, 60, what do they call them? Silver ones that are just look like a bullet. Silvers? Airstream. I don't know who designed them things. I get the aerodynamics, but when you're 6'4", and you got to take a shower in the, it's not even a corner. It was designed for Christians or Aaron's height. I mean, they're trying to take a shower like this. Then you add the fact that it's, you know, as old as Methuselah, everything was taken on the smell so bad, I kept my clothes in my car. Now, I will say this. I never said a word to the pastor. And I preached just as hard for him as I did the dude that flew me in. See, we always try to negate how we treat people by how they treat us, except for when it comes to Jesus. I just want to take a few moments to speak to you about how will you host the holy? How will you host the holy? Jesus said in Luke 24 and 49, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. We like the power part. Some of us don't like the tarrying, and that's why he only had 120 show up. An invitation of Jesus to be ready because he's going to give you something. Acts 1 and 8 denoted and gave us a heads up of what it was going to be. But you shall receive. Everybody say receive. It's twice we've said that word. In our opening text, Martha received Jesus into her home. You see, it's a reciprocating relationship. Because when you receive Jesus in, he'll receive you in. But you shall receive power. You may receive me, but when you receive me, I'm going to give you something. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall be witness unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. How does that happen? Well, Jesus wanted to institute the church to give every person the opportunity and the invitation to be saved. So in Acts chapter 2, right after the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, in Acts chapter 2, verse 37, it says, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, how many remember who Peter was? He's the one that denied Christ. But Jesus still brought him back. And unto the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall, there's that word again, receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I want to give you a scripture that, if you'll take this spiritually, I hope it lights your fire. Luke 15 and 2 says, and the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eats with them. It's a lot of receiving going on. And I'm thankful that he receives sinners. And that door that was open to all the goody two shoes was open to the not so goody two shoes of this world. I'm thankful that he receives sinners because you see, the religious will push you away. Oh, no, no. If you don't have nothing to offer, man, I don't know that I really want anything to do with you. If you don't look like me, if you don't act like me, but I'm thankful that Jesus just said, and he receives sinners. He receives sinners. How many are thankful for that today? Jesus speaking said in John 14, if you love me, keep my commandments. Everybody knows in a relationship it's a two-way street. Jesus says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, one and the same, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, nor knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you, if you'll receive him. I will not leave you comfortless. And he says, I will come to you. You know, I know we get this Godhead thing kind of, oh, what's going on? I'm going to tell you something. The God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament. I know there's some things like, man, I don't know how that works, but he does. And that's all I need to know. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I know he's here to comfort. Maybe you don't need comfort, but I need comfort. I'm thankful that he receives sinners. In other words, if he'll receive a sinner, then I can receive him if I will open the door and let him in. Okay? The question is, how will you host the holy? He's asked to come in. Will you let him in? Will you let him in? Now you have to understand, I'm sorry. I'm glad I'm not blind. I got to watch some people here today that were all about, come in, Jesus. And then I saw others. I'm fine with that. You're probably the one he's working on the most. You see, John, who was the forerunner, to kind of give us a, hey, heads up, everybody. That thing that's been prophesied, it's coming. That promise that Joel said he's going to pour out a spirit upon all, hey, he's coming. The deliverer is coming. You see, he said in Matthew 3:9, I indeed baptize you with water under repentance. See, I'm only getting you to realize that we all need to repent. Yeah. What we've done with the plan of salvation, what we've done with the temple and the priest, you know, we just kind of fouled it up because all the religious people, boy, you got to put on some kind of airs of having something right before they're going to let you do anything, right? Well, God in his benevolence, his love and his astuteness and just his almighty godness said, okay, I'm going to fix this because the presence of God was restricted to just the few. And so when Jesus went to Calvary, and when he said it is finished, that was done away with. The veil was rent, and the power of God was released. In other words, he came knocking. If you're sick, I want in. If you're whole, I want in. I don't care. It doesn't matter where you're from, what you've done. If you're the adulterous woman, if you're Zacchaeus in a tree, I'm just knocking on every door I can find because I want in. I want. If you all understand what I'm saying, God has released his power. Because he wants in. That's what Pentecost is. I indeed baptize you with water and repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than. He's talking about Jesus. He's talking about the power. He's talking about the Holy Ghost. He says, mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Hallelujah. Undeniable experience. So how do you open up to allow this guest to enter? Repent, get baptized in Jesus' name, and open up to allow God to fill you with the Holy Ghost. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You see, The power of Pentecost is the fact that only God could bury someone in water and have them come out on fire. I'm thankful. Now, if you haven't experienced that, you're in the right place. And I want to just talk about hosting the Holy Ghost.
Yes, amen.
Hosting the Holy. Becoming the vessel of God. How will you host the Holy? Will you host the Holy? Revelation 3 and 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. Will you let him in? Will you let him in? You see, we forget. We don't think the outside matters anymore. We think it's the inside. Well, you know what? He can see the outside, but will you let him inside? What? Know ye not, 1 Corinthians 6, 19-20, that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? See, he did away with the old one. You are now the new one, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit. You see, inside and outside both matter. Oh, I want to act right. I want to look right. I want to dress right. I want to be right. I don't want the world to dictate how I dress and how I look and how I talk. I want God to feel comfortable. Anybody ever been invited over and ignored? Now, this didn't happen to me. It happened to an evangelist friend of mine. They went over to somebody's house that they were preaching for, and they asked for just a simple glass of water, and they watched as they went in the kitchen, opened the cupboard, shoot away a few cockroaches, grabbed the glass, dumped the cockroach out, filled it with water, and handed it to him to drink. Y'all look crazy. Don't be an evangelist if you ain't willing to drink it. What? It was normal to them. He received sinners. What, now you're going to dictate how bad a sinner? Oh, you're just looking for them clean people. You're just looking for them affluent people. You ain't willing to knock on the door if someone is down and out. Like one sin's not as dirty as another. How will you host the Holy? Have we become so pharisaical? Aren't you glad Jesus didn't come like us? We sit back and we judge our brother and say, oh man, she should dress, he should act. Don't look at how they're hosting the Holy, look how you are. Do you let him in or do you sit there unmoved, dictate? You're judging what you do by them and not by him. Therefore, glorify God in your body. And you can't sit there and glorify God. God knows my heart. He does. You know what he says about our hearts? It's desperately wicked. Who can know it? You know what he's saying? Y'all don't know it, but I do. In Noah's day, he looked on man and saw their thoughts are evil continually. I'm glad God doesn't put on these screens right now every thought that comes through yours and my mind. So you know why he wants to be on the inside? Because he can clean that mess up.
That's right.
Come on, how many of y'all know someone coming over the house, you pile everything up in one room and hide that, make the rest of the house look good? What, did I say that out loud? No, because I know none of y'all do that, right? Shove all them dishes in the dishwasher, clothes, and turn it on. I know none of y'all do that. Throw all your clothes in a bag and put it out in the garage because I'll do them next week. Why? Because you're receiving something in your house and you want to make sure everything. But you know the wonderful thing about Jesus? You know, he don't do that. Hey, Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house now. He don't care about none of that. He ain't worried about cockroaches and sin. I'll clean it up. I'll help you. You'll change how you live. You'll change how you talk. You'll change how you. Why? Because you're now walking with the Holy. How will you host? the Holy. That's what Pentecost is about. That's what Pentecost is about. No matter who you are, where you've been, what you've done, he'll come in and sup with you right now. Mercy house, clean house, poor house, rich house, outhouse. So understand, Mary and Martha give us a picture of the choice that we actually make. Will we host the holy, or will we be busy working in the flesh? It's a question we've got to ask today. It's a question as individuals, as families, as a church. Do we invite Jesus in our hearts, our homes, and our church? Do we invite him in on Sunday and ignore him until the next time we need him? I'm going to put a suit on and come on into church, and I'm going to speak sweet, and I'm going to speak kind, and then the rest of the week, you ain't even going to know I know who he is. But you see, you don't understand, you invite him, so he sits there in the corner of your house, waiting. You ever had somebody over, invite him, and get so busy you left him in, they're sitting in the living room? Let me paint a bit. Come on, you know that doctor's type visit. Your appointment is 12:30, you get there at 12:30, and you see the doctor is like 1:30. Aren't you glad when you need Jesus, he'll get to you? But can Jesus say the same about us? Are you so busy with all those things that you think are so important that the holy is shoved aside so you can do all those other things? You're so busy with the activity of life. You're just going kind of through the motions. You're just carrying on. You're busy in the flesh. You've got a wonderful list that you can brag about what's kept you busy. Jobs and business and errands and activities and hobbies and habits. And you're doing so many things. You're up at 2. You're up at 4. You're out there running in the heat of the day. You got all these things you can brag about. And then you give Jesus just a brief moment on a Sunday morning. You just toss a little attendance in your otherwise busy schedule and call it, I'm a child of the King. Have we neglected our guest like Martha? Have we substituted business for relationship? Can we admit that we may be making a whole lot of noise with all our busyness, but what we really need and what we really want is the power of the Holy Ghost in us? Is there anyone here who wants recompassion and refire and reignite and renew that relationship with Jesus and again make him primary, to make him a priority? Anybody want to make Jesus feel important? You ever wonder why we have a kind of relationship with Jesus, but there's no power there? Isaiah 10 and 27 is one of my favorite scriptures. It talks about the anointing that destroys the yoke. The yoke represents anything that hinders, binds, or oppresses. It holds you to something. It holds you to a sickness. A mentality. It holds you to an emotional state of mind or a physical disability. You see, that yoke can be a disease, it can be a debt, or it can be lack. Your yoke is anything that hinders you or binds you committed to something else. Are you hearing me? That yoke represents what the devil can put on you to steal your joy, to rob you of the abundant life that Jesus promises to give. Remember the parable of the excuses. Raise your hand. We all have an excuse why we don't do this, why we don't do that. Why I could sing on Sundays, but I can't make it on Wednesday. I could preach on Sunday, but I can't preach on Wednesday. I can be there, but I can't this. I got this. I got that. You see, the enemy wants you so yoked and bound by the things of this world that you never truly experience the power and freedom of the Holy Ghost in your life. So the devil is just really trying to be you so busy that you won't host the holy. He's more like that salesman that comes by now and then and you just like, oh, I can't do that today. Kind of like I treated that solar salesman I told you all about. What you coming here for? I'll see you Sunday. I got my schedule. And we wonder why the freedom, the power of the Holy Ghost is missing. Why am I still struggling with this and still battling that? Why do I still go here and go? Why is my... You see, it wasn't just Mary that sat at the feet of Jesus, one of the worst people ever mentioned in the Bible. Once he experienced Jesus, he was at his feet. The wild man of Gadara, he was at his feet, and the Bible says in his right mind. How many of us need to find that place at his feet and get our mind back? How many of us have been out of our mind, running around, chasing things, pursuing things? We got this. We think we got to have that. I got a barn. Let me build a bigger barn. I got this. I need another one. And we're chasing, and we're catering, and we're hosting all these other things while the Holy gets shoved aside. Are we too busy to receive the guests knocking on our door today? But not only do we have to ask the question, will we receive? But there's another word, make room. Will you make room for him? I know most of y'all been to my house. First thing I want to do is, hey, we got enough chairs for everybody. You've come over for Bible study or come over for snack or fellowship or whatever we're doing. I want to get chairs. I want to make room. You ever walk into someone's house and you go there for dinner and they got the table set and it's all laid out? Makes you feel what? Welcome. Because they expected you to be there. I like that feeling. Can you imagine Jesus standing there? There's an old song we sing. He's waiting. He was waiting patiently in line. He was there all the time. I'm sorry I got that inverted, but we don't even sing that enough around here. But is he waiting patiently in line? You're going to put the holy in line with the unholy? So not only do we need to make room, but let me use another phrase. Give place. Now that's going to invoke something, another scripture most of you read your Bible know. But you have to understand, if there's that side of it, there's the God side of it. Jesus stands at the door knocking today. Will you answer? And if you answer, will you let him in? And if you let in him, will you sit with him like Mary or you get back to your other business? We've all met him. The Bible lets us know he's not far from any one of us. But have you invited him in? God knows my heart. Well, let me just show you Acts 19, 1 through 6, and I got to be quick here. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples, he said to them, have you, what's the word, received the Holy Ghost since you believed? I get you know and you love Jesus, but have you let him in? And they said, and we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, under what then were you baptized? And they said, under John's baptism. Well, John even said, I'm only baptized in repentance. There's more after me. They missed it. They didn't realize what that other knock was for. They didn't realize there's more than just knowing Jesus is out there. When he knocks the door, you got to let him in. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so he reiterated, and to Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him, which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, They were, you know, they didn't argue. They didn't fight. Oh, well, that's how you believe. No, they, you know what it says? And they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. I don't want to just let him knock and know he's out. I want him in. Yes. And the Holy Ghost came on them and they spake with tongues and prophesied. Now that you've let him in, how will you treat him on the inside? Like Mary or like Martha? You have to stop and answer this question by actions because they speak louder than words. You have to ask yourself. There is nothing but the anointing that can break Satan's hold on you. So are there things that he still has a hold on you? Because if you're at the feet of Jesus, he can't. Even the demoniac was free at his feet. The power of Jesus, when you not only let him knock at your door, invite him in, you sit down and make room, and he'll deliver you. You won't be bound. You won't be oppressed. He can heal the sick. He will heal the disease. Listen, many places copy it, try to imitate it, but you cannot manufacture it. When the presence of God is like, when the anointing gets in, it breaks that yoke of bondage. There's only one place to get that anointing. That is from the fellowship and communion with the Holy Ghost. When you've got to get the Holy Ghost on, you've got to let him in. You've got to yield and say, come in, Jesus. Go ahead, that room that I shoved everything in that I don't want no one to know about. You're free to walk in there. And he'll walk in there with garbage bags and boxes, and he'll call that Mayflower company, should come pick up. Let me help you clean. Let me get all these burdens off you. Let me get this sin. Let me get this ugliness off. If you let Jesus come, he's the best house cleaner there ever was. Oh, wait, you don't think he cleans house? He cleaned his house. He just did it with a braided whip. But he's not going to do that now because we're in a different day. Let me in. I'll help you. Oh, no, don't. I see that sin. I see that lust. I see that worldly. I'll help you with that. He'll help you clean your house. He ain't going to sit there. Look at this filthy house. No. Let me help you. Let me help you. You receive me. I receive you. Let me help you with that. Let me love you. You see, the key ingredient that a church, that a family, that an individual Christian must have, Jesus made sure it was the focus on the very first church service. It happened on the day of Pentecost when it was fully come. They were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like a fire, and it sat upon each of them. Everyone got it. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance. You have to understand, you have to open the door. He will come in. And when you let him come in, you will speak. You yield that most unruly member. You will get the Holy Ghost, and it will come flowing out of you. I believe that without the power of the Holy Ghost, if we don't get it like that, the church is just going to be another casualty in the world of worldliness. Let me say this. Most secular churches today no longer allow the Holy Ghost to move. My wife and I were in a meeting with a church a couple of years back and said, no, we voted the Holy Ghost out of our church. You think I'm lying? That's a quote. Most churches preach against it. Oh, that's the devil. Really? Really? It's funny. These churches say they believe the Bible. They talk about Jesus. They'll pray in Jesus' name. It's funny. They still take up offerings. They'll even talk about sin. But they won't open the door to let Jesus in, because if Jesus comes in, he's in charge. They don't talk about receiving the Holy Ghost, because when you receive the Holy Ghost, you receive power.
Yes.
They don't want you to get that, because then you're going to realize that they're taking up those offerings so they can have a jet plane. So they can... What? What'd I say? I can't say that? We got people that aren't being told about the wonderful gift of receiving Jesus into their life. They're not worried about you. They want to be your hero. They want to turn a church into entertainment. Let me tell you the truth. If you're looking for a hobby to get involved in, or a religion to get involved in, I'll be honest, real Christianity ain't the one if you're looking for a whole lot of fun. It's a deny yourself. It's a take up your cross. See the problem? Some people, oh man, I've had a great and fun life. Well, God, that would scare me. Where's the fasting? Where's the denying? Why? How do you have so much if you're servant? How are you hosting the holy? You receive power. Power to what? Luke 10 says, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall be. You're a weak, anemic Christian, and you brag about worldly things, but you're anemic in the thing. Where? How are you hosting the holy? How have you hosted the holy? Where? He said, I've come in. Oh, you're going to have power. You don't have to walk around weak and anemic. The devil will easily make a trade. I'll give you all the things of the world. Just don't let Jesus in your house. I'll give you all this. I'll give you comfort. I'll give you blessings. I'll give you things and finances, status. Just don't host the holy. You see, it's not only churches that bypassed Pentecost because they're afraid to let Jesus be in charge. There are people that want to bypass Pentecost because they really don't want Jesus. They want Jesus as Savior, but not Master. They want heaven. They don't want Him. Is this too much? Is this okay? I'm trying to pull. I'm kind of like Toto over there, and the devil's the Wizard of Oz. And I'm like, I'm going to run over there like Toto. I'm going to pull that curtain back. See what's going on in the Christian world? They're hiding the truth from you. They want you to be bought into churches that have got slideshows and entertainment and concerts and all, and they never want to talk about getting sin and overcoming the wickedness and defeating the devil. That those are just bywords. It's not really something that happens. And they don't care if you're still struggling with worldliness, nakedness, peril, sin, depression, drugs, alcohol, cigarettes. Vices of all kinds. They don't really want, just come to church, but don't overcome anything. That's not a church, because the church is people that host the holy. Come in, Jesus. Lead the way. Take up my life. Help me walk in the ways of God. Well, that Holy Ghost is of the devil. When has Satan ever told the truth for the good of someone's soul? Really? You're going to tell me what I got is of the devil when before I got it, I can show you another story. But since I got it, my God, he been cleaning up my house. Either we're going to be saturated, inundated, and endued with power from on high so we can fight back with the power of the Holy Ghost, or we're going to end up as a casualty of war. If we're going to have the power of the Holy Spirit, we've got to say, I'm going to host the holy. Let's stand. I know I'm resistant to say, I'm going to be very careful what I say because I have an idea what's coming down the pipe. But if you want to catch the wind of God's Spirit, you have to be where the wind blows. We need the Holy Ghost, because it is the anointing of the Holy Ghost that gives us the power over the devil's kingdom to destroy his works in and around our lives, to break the power and set people free. That is why we have to be like Mary and learn the art of entertaining the presence of the Lord. Don't think it's a coincidence that this world is caught up in entertainment. We have to constantly, let me tell you something, I love you, and I don't know why I'm telling you, get that phone out of your baby's hands. Don't you trust what's coming? You know, as a pastor, and we talk all the time. It blows my mind what I'm hearing, how they're sneaking stuff in. And in fact, I was told that recently they literally are holding drag shows so these drag queens can walk up and down a catwalk with little 8-year-old boys. Well, y'all think I'm crazy? They want to teach children in our schools. Wait a minute. You got to be 18 to drive, but you can 5 to change your gender? The devil's, there's something afoot here, but you know why it goes on?
Out, Pastor. Let's go.
Oh, America's a Christian nation. No, they may go to church, but
that's right.
They're not hosting the holy.
Amen.
So I'm going to give you 3 phrases. Make room. Make room. I'm not saying this for me. I am saying this for you. How will you host the holy if you're truly going to host the presence and the power and the Spirit of God in your life? When you obey Scripture, you yield yourself and you receive the Holy Ghost, evidence of speaking in other tongues, no doubt. That's how there's no doubt. That's how there's no doubt, biblically. We can have a Bible study on that if we want to. We don't need to. Give me privately if you want that one. You see, make room means to do whatever is necessary to make a place for someone or something, to move things around, or to discard things, or even add extra space. It's to make room on purpose because you're making it a priority. You ever walk into somebody's house and they clear a spot just for you? There's a couple in the Old Testament where the prophet would come by and say, you know what? I want to make a room for him. I don't want him to pass by. I want him to stay. If you want Jesus to stop just passing by you in a church service, make room for him at home. The next phrase is give place. And this is different from make room. But this can't happen without making room first. To give place means to yield. To submit. By extension, it means to want and desire. That's why some of you, well, I've done this, but he doesn't seem to move. You gotta want him. You gotta be willing to say, Jesus, you can have this. I'd rather have you. It's not, oh, I got you, now I'll get rid. You give him place. In other words, and I'm not saying you have to do this. This is me. I'm just using when I came here to pastor this church, I wanted to make room, but I wanted to give. I hunted and fished. Brother Schooler, understand me. It's still a trial every year. I walk outside and I smell a certain weed growing. Because I was intense. I was an intense hunter. There was a weed that would start growing on my property. And as soon as I got that testosterone infused masculine boot. Well, I don't have no biceps or chest anymore, but anyway, I realized and I'd start, let it get to start. I'd water it and I would gather it and I would take all my hunting clothes. Y'all gonna think I'm crazy. You girls gonna think I'm crazy. I gather all that stuff up and I put all my hunting clothes in garbage bags with that weed. Not weed, a weed. I got help, some of y'all. Y'all, pastor hitting that? No. Only I can mess up an ending. Only I can mess up. Y'all think, oh man, he's smoking that green bud. No. A weed that grew in my yard. A really pungent smelling weed. It wasn't sage, it was something else. In fact, it kind of cracked me up because I found some here in Phoenix the other day. Well, I caught that. So, I was instantly in the woods. I would just, because, Randy. When I get to the woods, step out of my truck, I strip down, wash myself off with baking soda and other things, and I put those clothes on. Why are you doing all that? Let me tell you something. I've had deer, if Brother Aaron was me, I've had deer walk right up to me like this. I've been that close to deer coming up to me one way, because I smell like a bush. Let me explain. If I put a table in your house, you go home and go, what's this doing here? That's what those deer do. What bush is this? What this bush? I've been coming through this. This is my living room. There's a new bush here overnight. I've had elk, and a herd of elk walk right by me. You're me. I could have touched him. I wanted to be able to be in their world. So I did all these things to sneak in there to have an advantage. I'm not going to go down that way. I can preach on that, but I'm not going to do that. You hear what I'm saying? I was so into hunting and fishing, I did crazy things to be good at it. Some of us we've gone to great lengths to have or to be good at something. Let me ask you, how will you host the holy? So I threw all that aside because, you know what? I didn't want to just be pastor. I wanted to be a pastor. I wanted to be a real deal pastor.
Amen.
Setting aside all that because I wanted the church to be a priority, not a pastime. I wanted the church to be a passion and not an amusement. Not something that I ran to at the last minute, but something that I love and want to be a part of every day. So I gave place to it. I make room, I give place, because I want to make sure the Holy Ghost could speak to me in my life. And he can't do it if you're busy doing other things. Now understand, that give place has another meaning. It says neither give place to the devil. So if we aren't to give place to the devil, we need to give place to God.
Yes.
You go read that in Ephesians 4. That's a great chapter. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And the third one I'm going to do, accommodate. Accommodate. Simple word. This goes even further than the first two. It means to make comfortable. I don't want to say something, do something, be a part of something that makes God uncomfortable. It means to seek to please, to create a desired environment. It means to consult with, having a desire to please. The beautiful thing about the Holy Spirit is that he's a perfect gentleman. He's a perfect gentleman. I wonder if there's anybody here today that would like to invite the Holy in. You see, the Holy Spirit is not just tongues. The Holy Spirit is not just power. The Holy Spirit is power in you. And if we want to have the power of the Holy Spirit, we've got to host the presence of the Holy Spirit.